Grace and peace to you from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. As always, welcome to the Grace Place, and I'm glad you're here today. I have a few announcements this morning. Again, we've asked you to sign the registration pads and little red books that are located somewhere in a pew near you. And then I do want to thank our kids who taught our adult Sunday school classes this morning. They did a great job. The next question is, we'll have to do that on a regular basis. For those of you who did not manage to make it here in time to come to school, so you'll have a chance to hear them in the future. And if you would like one of the remaining lilies, please take them to your lilies today. If not, Joanna's going to make them take them to my house. So please take them today. The Lois Whipper Circle, or Women's Ministry, will be this Tuesday at 11 o'clock in the team room. Please bring your lunch, ladies. Drinks and dessert will be provided. Then I want to thank those who helped bag groceries at the Westock Fish Food Pantry last Saturday. We'll also be bagging this coming Saturday morning at 9:30. If you can help, please contact Betty Hamill at her note. And then next Sunday, following our worship service, our stewardship and finance committee will meet. Let us now prepare our hearts to worship the living Jesus.
Thank you.
together with your people to continue celebrating the resurrection. It is hallelujah, hallelujah, Christ the Lord is risen. We praise you and we thank you for that resurrection and what that means in our lives today and every day. We ask now for forgiveness, dear Father, that you'll open our hearts so that we can allow that risen Christ to come in and change us to become more and more and more like him. That is our goal day by day, Father, to be more and more like Jesus, your Son and our Savior. It's in his name I just pray. Amen.
Now if you'll turn over to 366 and then the first 1 and 3 of 366.
Thank you.
proclaim in unison the Apostles' Creed, which says, I believe in God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, sitting upon the right hand of God, Father Almighty. For this he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. If you do so, please join me in this time of prayer. Forgive us of this, Father, and help us to overcome that tendency in our lives. Help us to overcome temptation. Help us to choose your will and not ours, so that our will can succumb you, or probably more clearly, your will become ours. Lord, we desire to do what you desire for us. And Lord, as we gather here this morning, we know that we have many on our hearts and minds and our prayer list. We have those who are grieving recent death of loved ones. We have those who are visiting family in the hospital even this morning as we're here. We have those who are battling their own illness and injuries. We have one who has returned from a significant illness. And Lord, we're just thankful and grateful that we're here. But we lift up all of these folks, whatever their need is. Some needs to have even mentioned. Spiritual needs, financial needs, relational needs, whatever they are, we know that your word teaches that your grace is sufficient to meet our needs. So Lord, we are just asking this day that your grace pour out upon us and upon those whom we lift up in prayer. May it be a flooding grace, Father, a grace that is recognized by its recipients, a grace that causes people to give you the praise and the glory for your great and mighty touch. And now, if you would, please join with me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, glory forever. Amen.
Oh.
invitation to give Genesis 20 comes from the book of Acts, where Luke writes, "In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak, remembering the words of the Lord Jesus himself said, 'It is more blessed to give than to receive.' Let us now honor God through our giving."
Thank you. I'm gonna scoot in a little bit. I got a magic trick for you today.
I do, I have a magic trick.
Scoot in right to the middle.
Just down.
That was good. Right.
I'm going to fold it in thirds.
Okay.
And two paper clips.
One paper clip.
Two paper clips.
They're separate, right?
What do you think's gonna happen when I pull this apart?
My paper clips are going to be magic, and they're gonna link together. Okay, so you have to watch it, tell me where it falls, okay? Are they stuck together?
Yeah. Yes.
What, in a Harry Potter?
Let's do it again one more time. Do you believe it?
No.
No? We're gonna do it again, okay?
I don't know if you can do it right now.
Fold it in first. Fold there. And there's there.
I'll do it.
Are they stuck together?
Yeah.
They did, they linked together. Can you believe it?
No.
No?
I wanna do it.
Help tell a story about something that happened in the Bible, okay? And every time I say the word believe, I need you guys to make a Home Alone face. Do you know what that one is?
You can't believe it.
It's an excited face, okay? Every time I say the word what?
Believe.
You guys are going to make that face, okay? So, one evening, on the first Sunday after Jesus had been crucified, his disciples were together in a locked room. What's a locked room mean? No one can get in or out, right? If the door's locked, okay? They were afraid of those who crucified Jesus. Suddenly, Jesus appeared there in the locked room with the disciples, and it was hard to believe. They saw him, and Jesus showed them the wounds in his hands, and so they knew it was him. One of the disciples that was not in the room was Thomas. When they told Thomas, he didn't believe. He had seen Jesus crucified and buried. How could he be alive? Thomas said, unless I see the wound in his side and put my finger in the holes where the nails were in his hands, I will not believe it. A whole week later, the disciples were back in that locker room again, and this time Thomas was in there with them. And Jesus came and stood among the disciples, and Jesus said to Thomas, put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Thomas fell to his knees and answered Jesus, my Lord and my God. You guys think you'd be excited if you saw Jesus? Jesus said to him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. Okay. You guys, we've never seen Jesus with our own eyes, right? Right? The question is, are you going to be one of those who is blessed to believe it? Are you going to believe it even though we haven't seen it? Yes? All the doubts away and everything like that? Okay. So just because you haven't seen Jesus doesn't mean that you don't what? Alright, you don't have to do it anymore. We're going to close back and serve it. Dear Lord, thank you so much for your sacrifice for us and for giving us the choice to believe in your risen Son. We thank you every day for that. Please be with us this week and bring us all back safe and healthy again next week. In your most precious name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
said she had a magic trick, took out that $1 bill and she folded it. And Thurs put the paper clips on it. I was paying a lot of attention. Because I was positive when she pulled it apart and pulled me a 10, that I was going to give her the offering and let her do that same thing for the rest of the afternoon. Thank you. It was a great job. I was right along the well where we're going this morning. But before we go any further, I need to stop and wish you a happy second Sunday of Easter. Second Sunday. For those unaware, the church celebrates not one, not two, but seven Sundays of Easter. Seven. That is seven Sundays plus 43 weekdays for a total of 53 days that's designed to be non-stop celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Non-stop. On the church calendar, there's a time frame between Easter Sunday last week and Pentecost Sunday, 7 weeks later, is known as the Great 50 Days of Easter. And the prolonged nature of this celebration reflects the centrality of the resurrection of Jesus in our own Christian lives. Even though most believers clearly acknowledge the significance of the resurrection of Jesus to their faith, many, if not most, congregations pack up shop the week after Easter, that's today, and quickly get back to quote-unquote regular church business. We treat Easter like a one-day event, therefore we get a big crowd on Easter Sunday, and that's because over the years we've failed to help people realize they can't celebrate something that big in one little We need weeks, weeks of worship focused on the resurrection. This morning, if your mind has already slipped into a post-Easter mode, know that you're not the only one who has ever had trouble catching and keeping the Easter spirit. In fact, we're going to read about a group of disciples that struggled with that this morning. So with all that said, I'm going to ask you to please rise in body and spirit in honor of God's word. It's recorded in John chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. You'll recognize part of this from the children's sermon. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, that is that first Easter Sunday, the doors of the house of the disciples had never locked for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, Jesus showed them his hands and his sides. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, Jesus breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was also called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came on that first Easter. The other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in my hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hand. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Then Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Now notice, nothing in here that said Thomas touched. He asked to touch, but nothing, just seeing the risen Jesus, just encountering the risen Jesus was enough. He didn't have the proof he so desired. Sometimes we don't get all the proof we so desire either. We just see and trust speaking up, Jesus said to Thomas, "Have you believed because you have seen me?" The implied answer is, "Most certainly." Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. To believe, that's us. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written, the whole gospel in fact is written, so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. The word of God to the people of God.
Thank you, God.
Let's pray today. Lord, we come before you again this morning, and we ask now that you speak to us as clearly as you did to the disciples on that first Easter and the second Sunday of Easter as well. That you speak to us in a way that we know that you are real, and that we believe and have life. In your holy name. Amen. You may be seated. If we were not familiar with the Easter story, and we had just heard about the resurrection, by mid-morning on that first Easter Sunday, we might expect the disciples to be partying in triumph. I mean, he's alive. They've seen him. Or maybe we are rejoicing with one another. But the disciples were not, if we read the story. Instead, we read in our text today that they had locked themselves up in a small room because they were afraid. They were afraid of the Jews that had executed Jesus, yes. But I believe they're pretty much afraid of everything. One little squeak by a mouse would have sent them into a panic. They are afraid deep in their soul. They were not living as Easter people. The disciples were huddled together with the door closed and locked. Again, not like Easter people, but they were living like cowards. The disciples have a somewhat blemished reputation for their post-Easter behavior, especially Thomas, who's been unfairly dubbed Doubting Thomas for all of Christian history. All he did was ask to see what the others had seen. He wasn't asking for anything special, and yet we hung that moniker on him as if somehow he's inferior. At this point in the story, they had only heard once that Jesus was alive. Once. This they had heard from Mary Magdalene, who had been running all over town talking about an empty tomb and a dead man walking. But instead of joining her, they hid in a room behind a locked door. Mary Magdalene, she's telling everybody, he is alive. Who would believe that? Julie focused on the word believe a minute ago. Who would believe that? Would you have believed that if you had been there that day? Would you have believed the story of Easter the first time around? By the time we pick up the story in Scripture, if you had been alive, would you have already started the party? The celebration? Would you have? This year, I celebrated my 64th Easter. That's what it hurts my feelings to say that, but I celebrated my 64th Easter. Which means that I've heard the Easter story 64 consecutive Easters. And I'll tell you something, I'm making a confession. I still have trouble wrapping my head fully around the story. It's amazing. It doesn't make sense. Dead people don't walk. But it's there. And you've lived a few less or maybe even a few more Easters. And my guess is that you too still find this whole idea of resurrection difficult to comprehend. That's because it's not an easy thing to believe. I mean, who here has ever seen a dead man walk? No, a lot to take in then and now. The disciples, though, I believe, were a lot like us. They were skeptical. They were practical. They were sensible. I also guess they might have been just a little bit thick-headed. In fact, if we read any of the stories of the Gospel of Mark, we'll come to the conclusion pretty quick that they're thick-headed. It was no wonder that after hearing Mary Magdalene's witness, they did not believe it right away. Now, she did go and tell two of the disciples, Peter and most probably John. They ran to see and saw that the tomb was empty, but they went back to the house. They had a door to lock. They didn't believe it yet. According to the Gospel of Mark, after she encountered the risen Jesus, Mary Magdalene went out and told those who had been with him while they were mourning and weeping. When they heard that he was alive, that is, when they heard that Jesus was alive and had been seen by her, they would not believe it. This is the disciples. This is those who walked with Jesus closely for 3 years. This is those who Jesus had told at least 3 times that he was going to Jerusalem to die, but on the third day, he rose again. And they did not believe it. And that is precisely why on that first Easter, instead of celebrating, the disciples were holed up in some little room, a place I imagine being something like a bomb shelter. You know, it's narrow, it's got bad air, the windows are closed tightly, there's no light, there's a palpable atmosphere of panic and fear in that room. In that room of doom, the disciples were huddled together, locked into a living nightmare, making sure that everyone and everything stayed away. That was their plan. There's a problem with their plan, and that is that there is one who never stays away from his disciples. Suddenly, in the midst of the disciples, there in that locked room stood the risen Christ. 1 minute they were alone with their terrors and their doubts, and the next minute they will never be alone again. Peace be with you, Jesus said to those frightened and stunned disciples. When Christ granted them his peace, I imagine that it came rolling over them like an ocean wave, washing away all of their fears. Maybe, Jesus threw open the door to let the daylight and fresh air flow in. Maybe he passed around a box of tissues so the disciples could dry their tears and blow their noses. Now, obviously, those details are not included in the text, but they fit well into my imagination. After Jesus had granted them his peace, he showed the disciples his hands and the wound in his side. Remember, this is what Thomas wants to see later. He showed them these things. And somehow, despite their shock and confusion, they managed to grasp that it really was God. Their best friend and brother, their hope, their Messiah, their everything was risen. That first Easter must have been the crown of the disciples' life. Could you imagine seeing the risen Jesus for the very first time? Of all they had seen and experienced, that day was surely beyond anything they had encountered in the previous 3 years. Walking on the water, no big deal. Feeding 5,000 with a little bit of fish and bread, not so impressive anymore. Even healing someone else's child or raising someone else from the dead, not near as impressive now that they've seen the risen Jesus. The crown jewel. Disciples saw touched the written word. And as if that was not enough, Jesus commissioned them into the ministry. And he sent them into the world, just as the Father had sent his Son. They were even given a foretaste of the gift of the Holy Spirit. What a day that must have been. Oh, what we would not give to have been among the disciples. To have seen with our own eyes and touched with our own hands. To receive Christ's peace. To feel the power of the Holy Spirit flowing down over that place. How are we even to imagine the joy that experience that day? It truly is beyond our conception. How can we imagine? During one brief encounter with the risen Christ, the disciples moved from despair to celebration, from darkness to light, for the choir sang this morning, no more night. They moved from death to life, from defeat to victory. Sometimes I catch myself thinking, if I'd been there, you ever thought that was really scary? If I'd been there, it'd been different. If I'd been there, I'd have been at the tomb waiting on Jesus to resurrect. I'd have been sitting out there waiting. Now I think that, but I'm most probably just fooling myself. Other times I think, if I could have a little bit of physical proof, some practical evidence to really stick my teeth into, or if I could see Jesus once, really just once, would do it, then I could lay aside any lingering doubts that I might have. But neither the evidence nor the experience seemed to have much of an initial effect on the disciples. We learned in 1 week, 1 week, 7 short days after the risen Jesus' first appearance to them, the disciples were back in that same room with the door shut once again and bolted. 1 week. They'd seen the risen Jesus, and in 1 week, fear had recaptured their lives. Instead of being out on the street sharing the good news, as the risen Jesus had told them to do, they had gone back into hiding. 1 week later, they were crippled again by fear. The glorious Easter experience all but forgotten. You see, it only took 1 week out in the real world for the disciples' fears to overshadow the joy of Easter. This is the second Sunday. I wonder how many times this past week fears of the real world, the world we live in day to day, overshadow our joy in Easter. It only took 1 week for the darkness of the world to smother the light of belief. So by the second Sunday of Easter, the disciples were back in the bomb shelter, waiting for the sky to fall. What is Christ's response to all of this? That he decided, I should have picked 12 better guys. I'm going to just wipe them out and get some more. He did not. When the disciples failed to believe Mary's eyewitness report, the risen Jesus came to visit them right where they were, holed up and locked up, right where they were. When that first visit proved unconvincing, and because Thomas still did not believe, Jesus, with apparently infinite patience, and Joanna informed me this morning that patience comes up somewhere on our drive from home to church, but I have none. Jesus, with his apparently infinite patience, simply paid them a second visit. No fussing, no stoning, just another visit. After all they've been through together, Jesus knew very well just how human his disciples were. He knew they were prone to doubt, that they were easily troubled, that they were a bit weak in the knees, but Jesus loved his disciples anyway. Don't miss that point. He loved them Anyway, he loved them right where they were, locked up in their fears, not once, but twice. Is that recorded in Scripture? Jesus loved his disciples when they did not have enough courage to share the good news of his resurrection. Jesus loved his disciples when they were paralyzed by fear and disbelief. He loved them enough to come back for, quote unquote, doubting Thomas, to come back to the one who did not believe. Jesus loved his disciples enough to personally come. Personally come. He had promised him to send the Spirit. He's trying to get us into his Father for good. That he would personally come and be with him in their fear. Not once, but at least twice. Jesus loved his disciples enough to absorb their doubts into his perfect peace. That's an imagery you don't hear much, but think about that. Peace, he absorbed it. He sucked all the fear out of them. He loved them enough to give them chance after chance to become people of great faith. That's how much he loved those disciples. And Jesus loves us, his current disciples, just as much. Not even a teacher has a little idea. Yes. He loves us just as much. Now know this, the disciples did not deserve a second visit of Jesus, but they got one. We do not deserve multiple chances either, but we get them. Jesus comes and comes again to his trembling disciples. Week after week, he shows up in the space of fear and doubt and stretches out his wounded hands full of mercy to invite us to believe. What an invitation it is. Invites us to believe. You and I have heard the Easter story more times than the disciples had. Probably more times than we can count. Yet no matter how many times Easter rolls around, there is some voice of doubt that continues to say, risen from the dead? Really? And week after week, Easter after Easter, the Son of God walked right into the thick of our fears and trembling and said, yes, I am alive. I am really alive. Christ's ultimate love and his refusal to let our fears and doubts get in the way of a relationship with him is good news for the trembling people of God on the second Sunday of Easter. We do not like to admit it. But the truth is that by this time next week, some of us will be right back where the disciples have been, hiding our faith behind closed doors, trembling in our fear, our Easter enthusiasm fading fast. After all, we too are merely human. We too are slow to believe, quick to doubt, and more often a little weaker than Jesus. But we can depend on the fact that even in our fears, the risen Jesus will not stay away from us. That's important. Mark it down. The risen Jesus will not stay away from us. In fact, those fears and doubts may draw him back quicker than anything else. He will not stay away. We can put as many locks and deadbolts on the door of your life, but the risen Christ will come to us. Our doubts will not keep him at bay. In our bomb shelters and through our doubts and disbelief, just when we are sure that this time the sky really is falling, the risen Christ will appear. there of peace. The vanquisher of death, the champion of heaven, will walk right into the midst of our lives. He promises to come and come again as many times as he can. As long as you and I have need, the risen Jesus. Risen Christ, we are like your original disciples, prone to doubt, full of fear, unsure of how to live as resurrection people. So Lord, I ask that you come to us this week and every week, not just for the next 6 weeks if the 50 days of Easter are celebrated, but this week and every week. Come to us, grant us your peace, your presence, grant us the lasting life of real faith.
You'll take your penalty stand because of 372. Our God reigns.
Even if you weren't in one of the classes, They still need to hear that you love them and support them. So don't rush out of here. Tell them.
Great job.
But that's it this evening. I'll just finish it. Believe in the risen Jesus.
For he is risen indeed.
And live accordingly by allowing him to come to you in the midst of your fears and doubts to bring you peace and strength and purpose. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.